Today, I am thrilled, absolutely thrilled, to be joined by Tristan Harris. He is now co-founder and president of the Center for Humane Technology, whose mission is to reverse human downgrading and realign technology with humanity. Tristan, thank you so much for joining us today.
Of course, Jessica, it's really good to be here. I'm excited to get into all this with everyone.
Awesome. Well, first, two things I want to say. First, thank you. Thank you for bringing to light this extremely important topic of our time in the social dilemma. For those of you who have not seen the film yet, we won't give away too many spoilers, but the social dilemma really disrupts the disruptors, right? So unveiling these sort of hidden, you know, algorithms, the words algorithms, these machinations that are happening behind everyone's favorite social media platforms and search platforms, et cetera. So, you know, it essentially, the film says human willpower is not strong enough to be able to compete, right, with these the most sophisticated AI that we have on the planet. So Tristan, share with us, right, like how did this start for you, right? How did, you know, your journey as a design ethicist at Google, you know, led you down this path or brought you to these realizations?
Yeah. Maybe relevant for this audience, you know, actually before this, people don't think I'm just some kind of Pollyanna activist or, you know, reformer type. I actually came from the tech industry. So I went to Stanford and studied computer science. My friends in college were the founders of Instagram and were many of the early employees of these companies. So I'm very close with and intimately familiar with and have attended the weddings of some of the people and, you know, whose business models we're now criticizing. And I had a technology company myself called Apture, which was a tiny, tiny, tiny negligible talent acquisition by Google about 8 years ago or something like that. So I know what it's like to raise venture capital, to play the startup game, to try to, you know, build your proof cases. And that's what really woke me up to what's really going on and how, no matter what narrative each startup founder I and my colleagues were, you know, knew about or talked about, whether it's the Instagram guys or others, it really boiled down to a race for human attention. Because no matter what service you're building, or whether you're running a political campaign, or you're running a conference, or you're running an investment bank, what do you need first to get a customer? You need to get their attention.
Right.
Can you vote for someone or vote for a proposition that you've not actually heard of or have heard any buzz about? No. Can you vote for a politician you haven't heard about or don't recognize? No. So it really is about attention. And I saw that that race for attention was getting more and more constrained because as everybody, you know, is feeling, and my first entree into this was actually distraction and feeling incredibly distracted constantly, the inability to focus, the inability to get anything done in the way that email could just hijack a day. I think people spend hours in Gmail and, you know, they just feel like after all those emails were sent back, like, was that a day well spent? Was that time well spent? Or did this just, you know, kind of empty calories of work? And I actually worked, after I got acquired by Google, I worked in the Gmail team. And so I was right there in the belly of the beast, thinking with the people, the designers, about what the next version of Gmail would be like. And as they talk about in the film, I found it fascinating that all the psychological issues with email, whether it's distraction or addiction or, you know, addictive checking, pulling the slot machine to see if you got more, or reading an email and then rereading it again tomorrow and again tomorrow, not responding, in that loop of anxiety that creates. I was wondering, would we try to tackle any of those psychological issues, distraction and addiction? And I found it fascinating that we weren't really tackling that. And I thought, if there was one group in the world that would care about the well-being of this sort of digital habitat, because email is a perfect example of a place where people really live a huge percentage of their work and personal life, hours a day in internet cafe, you'll see people have it open. And there really wasn't that conversation. And so then zooming back a little bit to give people context, I also have a background in human persuadability and the human psyche and what manipulates the human mind, because don't worry, I'm not manipulating you right now or
okay, good.
The lab at Stanford, I studied in a class called the Stanford Persuasive Technology Design class. And there's an associated lab run by a professor named BJ Fogg. And it really ingrained in me that the human beings are persuadable. And we were studying persuasion for good. Could you help people have the habits that they wanted to in their lives? You know, it's working out more at the gym or flossing. And then the founders of Instagram and I were in that class together. We actually worked on a project together that was about alleviating depression using persuasive technology. But many of the alumni of that class went on to work at the big tech companies, and you use that persuasive design to create more and more manipulative products because they were caught and trapped in this race for attention. And that's really what the film talks about, right? Is the way that all of the harms we're seeing boil down to not when technology overwhelms our strengths and IQ and takes our jobs, which is the singularity that everybody talks about. That's the, like, what's going to happen with AI taking humanity's jobs. There's this much earlier point where technology undermines human weaknesses. And really that diagnosis, which is in the film, is at the root of all of the harms that we're seeing. You know, our brains have short-term memory of 7 ± 2 things that we can remember. That's why phone numbers are 7 digits long. When technology blows past those short-term memory limits, we feel that as a problem called distraction or information overload. Like, I was just doing something and I was checking my email, but then I forgot why, and now I'm looking at something else. That's, you know, overloading our short-term memory. Or hacking our limbic system, our fact that we have early emotions for, say, outrage. And outrage, negative emotions last longer, stick around longer, and are more viral than positive emotions. And then that's how you get polarization, because the most outrageous stuff gets to the top of the news feed, and then we end up polarizing our societies. But really the lens that we use comes from a lens of how is the human mind hackable? And it's never been more obvious when you have, as you said, a supercomputer that's pointed at your prefrontal cortex, your executive control part of your brain at the front, which is really monitoring, you know, what am I trying to do and what are my goals and what am I, how do I stick to what I was intending to do, my willpower. That is the very thing that's being compromised by a supercomputer that's predicting the perfect thing to overwhelm or undermine those systems.
Talk through a little bit about the impact of social media on mental health and in society today.
Fundamentally, I think the issue is, you know, are the 1,000 engineers behind the screen, are they, when they make those supercomputers and predictive models to figure out, you know, what to show you next, are they asking what's best for you or for society or for democracy? Or are they just asking what would keep you on the screen? And their stock price is directly connected to what would keep you on the screen. So, you know, in terms of mental health, I mean, there's so many different things, right? So let's take a simple example. You know, Jessica, if you posted a photo on Instagram and you got 100 comments for that photo, and 99 of those comments are positive, like just everything's great, but one of those comments is negative, where does your attention go after? This is a universal human experience, because it were evolutionarily evolved to care about when there's negative people saying negative things about us, because our reputation's on the line with our tribe. So, but if you're a teenager, this is especially damning, because now it's never been easier to not just see the one negative comment, but to see the tree of then that person was retweeted by someone else, and then that person said it confirmed and piled on. And now you can go down the hate spiral. And then when you close the laptop or you close your phone and your mind is sitting there, you're doing something else, do you think your mind just automatically lets go of that? Or does it stay with you for the rest of the day? Another thing is the fame lottery, the idea that you know, we have a number of followers and we have a number of, basically the number of followers that we have. That sort of is sort of a status indicator for how much influence we have in the world. And when that was invented by some friends at Twitter, actually did that first and then Instagram followed, that was invented because it was a good way to get you to come back every day and to see how many followers do I have? Am I more famous than I was yesterday? It's sort of like, you know, he loves me not, like a mirror, mirror on the wall. You know, am I more famous than them all? And that was all done for this race for attention. And then that sets up this loop where it's this treadmill of there's always infinite reasons to see more likes, more comments, and for everyone. But the question is it leading or is it to a better society? And also, what is it displacing? Because now our society is hyper-focused and compressed into the present. It's almost impossible. Our attention spans have shortened dramatically over the last 10 years. But I think the real message of the film is, so long as we, the users, are not the customer, but we are the product, we're worth more when we can be turned into predictable automatons. And much like, you know, cows are worth more when we domesticate them for producing greater meat and greater milk. So we don't have regular wild cows. We have the kind of cows now that are best for us. My concern is that we're taking humanity, and there's like the wild, you know, alive and fulfilled and free and informed humans that are kind of, we could at least aspire to some notion of who we could be at our best as humans. But we're actually worth more when we're addicted, distracted, polarized, narcissistic, attention-seeking, and disinformed. than if we're this alive, free, informed human being, or an alive child who's playing with their friends off the screen. Because that child is worth more if they're a 15-year-old caring about the number of Instagram followers they have and making $10,000 a month and looking at their comments and addictively posting more photos than if they're actually just free, you know, as a human. So that's really what we have to change at the end of the day.
When you look into the future a little bit, maybe it's only 3 to 5 years, right? Like, you can't predict too far out, but what do you see in a positive way?
Well, I think it's the degree to which we're willing to make radical changes, the degree to which we understand how much is at stake. Because for example, I think it's important for everyone to get, no matter what you care about, you could care about human trafficking, you could care about climate change, you could care about racial inequality, you could care about any of these existential topics that we have to deal with. Our ability to work on that problem, like take climate change, which I'm very passionate about, depends on us on our ability to see the same reality and understand the timelines that we have. Because if everyone understood the same things, we could coordinate on how we want to fix it, right? But right now we live in a world where we don't understand the same things.
Right.
We have, you know, a bunch of people, a large percentage of the population who doesn't believe in climate change. And as we talk about in the film, if you type in climate changes into Google, whether you saw climate change as real or climate change as a hoax depended on not what was true, but where you were searching from.
Right.
So
right.
If you're searching from a high fracking country, you might see climate change as not real. By the way, one fun thing for your listeners is, we'll talk about Russia manipulating the election. One of my favorite examples is Russia actually went into pro-environmentalist groups who were anti-fracking, and they actually dialed them up so they could be, they were sort of putting their bot armies to amplify all the anti-fracking groups. Yes. Why? Because if the United States is against fracking, it's more reliant on foreign oil and it makes Russia more viable, et cetera. So there's a lot of games that are being played here. But I think that what we have to do to get regulation, these other things to happen, I'm actually hoping that an incoming Biden administration, if we can get past the current polarized moment, would actually treat this as an issue on par with economic recovery. It's almost like democracy recovery,
right.
And specifically a kind of digital recovery of our society. And taking seriously, and I don't, but I want, when I say this, I want people to understand, I don't mean the government regulates what people can and can't say, right, mm-hmm. and free speech. Mm-hmm. It means asking the question of what kind of social media environment and business models would upgrade our capacity to make sense of the world and make choices together and solve problems, and what business models are going to fundamentally lead us into conflict.
I know you you touched on the new administration. So given the economics that are fueling the division through social media, juxtaposed with the politics of our country and of the world, what realistic solution do you propose?
Well, I'm actually just thinking about this in real time. I mean, it's the last 24, 48 hours I've become really convinced that we need to make some kind of TV or Netflix series, or just, that's going to take too long, frankly. We need immediate demonstrations of people being able to, from their micro realities, have a conversation and actually open up a shared reality. We need right. demonstrations of that. We need evidence of that. We need to help break down how it is that we got to be so polarized and everyone is operating from the politics of grievance because they think they've seen infinite evidence of the other side being unfair, mean, you know, angry, naive. And everyone has seen infinite evidence of that because there actually is infinite evidence of the other side being naive, mean, unsympathetic, et cetera. And if we live from that space of grievance, we are never going to solve our problems because there's only escalation from there. And as we say in the film, where this goes in that case is more towards conflict and civil war. And we have to show that that's not actually going to be a better result for anyone, even though it right. might seem like it's better. And I think the nice thing is that people are actually unaware of the degree to which social media has really splintered us into these micro realities. When people hear it, the one thing I'm very excited about, to be honest and optimistic about, is that everything we've been talking about the last hour has actually been received positively by both sides of the political aisle. We have incredible fans that are on the left and on the right, for this is the thing that's making us all go crazy. And I think that is so exciting, that the one thing that can make us, you know, nonpartisan is the way that technology drives up partisanship.
Right.
You know, the one thing that can reclaim common ground is the revealing of how common ground got destroyed.
Right.
And so I think now that what the film does, I think, is create common ground about the breakdown of common ground.
Well, Tristan, I feel like I could continue with you for quite some time, but we want to be mindful of everyone's time and your time, most importantly. I want to thank you so much. And it's nice to end on this that positive note. Thank you so much.
Really enjoyed doing this with you. And I hope people can check out more resources if they want at the Humane Tech website. So
will do. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.